Not quite, mate. Not quite. If I have a good 5 Weet-Bix in the morning, I'm set for the day.
He's a big man. He needs 5.
That is.
All right, come on in. Come on in, someone.
Bring it in, guys. Bring it in. Bring it in. We want everyone to take 2 steps forward. 2 steps forward, you.
There's something under that. I don't know.
Alright, so guys, we have a game involving mousetraps up here, so I thought all three of us would just tell a story about our worst mousetrap story. Our worst mouse story, actually.
The worst mouse story.
Yeah. Mine is, we went on a 3-week holiday, and there was 2 mice in the pool from, like, it was probably 2 weeks in, they drowned. And they were stuck in the lid of the pool. And so I had to pull the lid while avoiding touching the 1-week-old mice and getting them out with the pool scoop. So, yeah, that was my mouse story. What about you, James?
Well, my mouse story actually doesn't involve any mice. So this was when I was quite young, and I went into a cupboard, and our cupboard used to back onto, like, Our cupboard used to back onto, like, it was kind of beneath our house. There was damp, there was rocks, creatures could get in. And I saw this little tail poking out from inside my shoe, and I thought, it's a mouse, it's a small little white tail. And so, you know, I'm like, I don't want to touch it, I'll call my dad. This was when I was young. I'm like, hey dad, there's a mouse in my shoe, can you get it out? It's a mouse. Of course I can get it out. He was big. I was in year 7 or whatever. He's like, yeah, I can deal with a mouse. Comes over, shakes a shoe, and out falls this little white baby snake onto the floor of our kitchen. Now, thankfully, I didn't know this at the time, but there's a type of snake called a pot plant snake. They're blind. They're kind of like a big worm, honestly. But it's still a snake, and it was still terrifying at the time.
That's a pretty cool mouse story.
It doesn't involve a mouse, but that's what I got.
Alrighty, so we've got a game involving mouse traps, but we need a couple of volunteers. So can we get one volunteer to show us how to do it first? Johnny!
Of course it's Johnny.
Oh, number 2. Elijah, you're second.
Alright. Now, can we have another brave volunteer from the crowd to demonstrate how much these mouse traps hurt? In response, you'll get a Mars bar. We just need someone to show. You want it? All right.
Elijah's keen.
Elijah's hand.
I reckon your hand is on the line. All right, everyone want to count him down from 5?
Just got
your hand on the mouse trap.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Did it hurt?
Yeah, I guess.
It did hurt.
He's so strong.
He's strong.
He's won his Mars bar. And have a second. Give it to a friend.
Alrighty, so our first brave volunteer, Mr. Jonathan Woodcock, if you can step up to the mantle, please. This here, mate.
Just behind there.
So the aim of the game is to put 2 hands into the box and to pull out the Mars bar inside the box. However, as you can see from here, there is mouse traps everywhere. Alrighty.
We got some hand holes on the side.
Put your hands inside the box, Johnny. And let's count him down to start getting there is a block of chocolate somewhere within this box. Okay, let's count him down to find the block of chocolate. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go.
You can stop when
this
you
is brutal.
Oh no.
He's so close. He's so close.
He's. Oh! He was
He's
so
gone
close.
To town. He's gone to town.
Have you lost him out? Have you lost the chocolate, mate?
Where's the chocolate, Johnny?
Yeah.
Have I got it?
You got it?
I got it.
Nice one. Have you got it?
Have you got the chocolate, Johnny?
Where's the chocolate?
Mate, you've
he's got the chocolate. Give him a round of applause. He will get
Good
another
job,
couple
Johnny.
Of chocolates on top of that.
Now, Johnny, was that worth it for this beautiful Mars bar?
Yes.
It's always worth it for a Mars bar.
Alrighty, can I get someone else's mouse story? Does anyone have a good mouse story in the audience as we reset the mouse traps?
Or a rat story. Mouse and rats, they're pretty much the same.
Yes, we've got a mouse story down here. What happened?
A death of a mouse.
A death of a mouse.
Yeah, so one day it was mouse season, so mouse were all over. Mice were all in our house, and then once we heard the mouse trap go off, except when we went to get it, the mouse wasn't dead, so my dad put his hand around the mouse's body and head and then twisted its neck to death.
That's pretty brutal. Does anyone have another mouse story? That was pretty good though. What size mouse was it?
It was really big.
It was really big. Does anyone have a better mouse story than that?
Rat story.
A rat story. Tell me more.
Oh, well, there was dead rats in my bath.
That'll be the last one, mate.
Dead rats in your bath. Gross. Yuck.
Right, you're good.
Imagine having a bath with dead rats. Yuck. What have you got?
Well, right now, there's a bunch of rats all over my house in the roof.
In the roof? How many?
I've heard like three.
Three rats. And are they big?
They're like...
That's big. That's
Alrighty.
Big.
We have our second contestant.
We're ready to go.
Are you ready? Let's see if you can
Let's
do it a bit
down,
faster
guys.
And a bit more precise
four,
than Johnny.
Three,
two, one.
Go.
Oh, he went for the brute force method, and in the process,
still in there, mate.
He
try
lost
again,
his
try again.
Shot,
He's got it.
Go.
He's got it. Give him
He's
a round of applause.
Alrighty. Thanks for playing, guys.
Okie dokie, that was quite a fun game. I couldn't have done that because my fingers would hurt. Welcome up. So, are we all keen to get into some praise and worship? Yes. Okay, I need it better than that. Are we all keen to get into some praise and worship? That is more like it. All right, Image is ready to go, aren't you?
Yes, all right. Let's kick it then.
We're going to do some warm-ups.
Good idea.
Mitch, pump some music for us. We'll do some warm-ups. What do we got to start us off?
Maybe the Maddie Bird step touch.
Oh.
Rowan, what's next?
Just get the arm into it.
Imogen, have you got a dance move for us? Here we go.
Maddie Gates, you got a dance move for us. Come on up.
Look at him go.
Give us a dance move.
Here he goes. Got to get the hair moving too.
Yeah. Helps if you got a mullet.
Nice. Awesome.
All right, let's get a bit of a bop. Bit of a bop.
Here we go. Come on. Yes. Come on, to the front.
Joe's showing us how to do it. Come
here
on,
we
up,
go,
Joe.
Joe.
Come on, guys, let's jump. All right. Let's get into some praise and worship.
Awesome.
Good job, Josh.
I was searching for something I knew was there but couldn't see. I remember the moment when the one I was searching for found me. I can make sense of it, no getting over it. How much your love changed everything. Well, 'cause I know you now, how could I go without Jesus? You're more than God, I need like I needed to breathe. I won't take you for granted. I won't go back to how I used to be. I can't make sense of it, no getting over it. How much you love changed everything. Oh, 'cause I know you now. How could I go without Jesus? You're more than enough for me. I don't need anything else. I need your love. There's just one thing, I need. 'Cause there's just
guys, exciting news. We have a new song to introduce. Now this song, I love it, it's amazing. It is such a declaration of God's love and salvation over our lives. And it's called Revival Anthem. If you know about anything about anthems, they're catchy, they're great, and you sing them all the time. So if we can get the chorus lyrics. So this is our revival anthem. Can you feel the darkness shaking? We are the dry bones rising. This will be our great awakening. This is our revival anthem. Isn't that amazing words to sing that over our lives and our situations that we're in? So, to get used to this new song, we've got a bit of a fun thing going. We're gonna get some claps, some dance moves, and get into it. All right, so ready? This is the way that we dance when we're in this song. Are you ready? So.
Let's do it. That's good energy.
Let's get into it. Let's use that energy in our worship, shall we?
Yeah.
Jesus, for that amazing time of praise. But now that we enter in this moment of worship, we just open our hearts to you completely and fully, Lord. Lord, we just pray that in this moment of worship that we just give everything to you, Lord, that you can have it all. Lord, that we can come and meet you in this place as we know that you're here. Lord, let us be with you in this worship and focus on you, Lord. Let's not worry about our friends next to us or who's singing behind us, but let's focus solely on you and your glory and your power as we're worshiping. Thank you, Jesus.
To find. Oh. In the so long to believe it, that you choose someone like to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve it. You take the broken, raise them to glory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you won. I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I'm seated in the heavenly place, undefeated, with the one who has conquered it all. Now I can finally see it, teaching me how to receive it. Submit all the striving. This is my victory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand by defeated. Every battle you've won. I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I see it.
As we sing this, like, these words are so powerful. Like, as we're saying, every wall comes crashing down. Can we get those bridge lyrics up if that's all right? Every wall comes crashing down. Like, Jesus has given us the authority to go into battle and to win in his name, yeah? So when we go into battle, we know that we've already won because Jesus has won the victory for us. Let's sing these lyrics because we know the truth of it. It's the, and the power that it has over it, yeah?
Every wall comes crashing. By the power of your name, I'm seated in the heavenly place, undefeated by the one who has conquered it all.
Lord God, we thank you so much that that is our truth, that we are seated in a heavenly place, not because of anything that we have done, but from everything that you did for us, Jesus. That, Lord God, you were our champion. That, Lord God, you were our Savior. And Father God, right now in this place, we thank you that you are here. That, God, you want to meet with every single one of us. That your presence is in this place. And whether we feel like we know you or we even deserve to be in your presence, whether that is truth for us or not, Lord God, we know that you want to take your rightful place upon our hearts. And so if you're comfortable right now, I just encourage you to raise your hands and surrender. We do this in an act of surrender to our Heavenly Father, to invite him in, to say, Lord, you can have it all. God, you can have my heart. You can have my life. I know that I can't do this on my own. I need you, God. I need you to be my champion. And as we receive that tonight, we have the authority, as that bridge proclaims, we have the authority to trample on snakes and scorpions, to trample on the enemy's head who is trying to target us. Because of our champion, we have the victory. We have the authority. We can see miracles outworked through the mighty power of the Holy Spirit working in us. And so, Father God, we just want to thank you tonight. We want to invite you into this place. We want to ask you to continue to move, both outwardly, but more importantly, inwardly. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen, everyone, amen. How good, let's give God a hand. So great to be here doing Frontline Live with you all. Who's excited for the word tonight? Are we excited? Yeah. So pumped. Before we get into that, we're going to invite you to get your bean bags over the side here. If you can quickly get one, bring it back in the middle, get a comfy spot. Get your spots. Oh, look, and I almost forgot something on stage. I don't know where it is. I was just going to whack one of these ones on tonight. It's a bit cold in here, don't you think? It's a little bit cold in here. Better get our scarves out. Can I hear a, we are the Navy Blues, we are the order. Yes. Sorry, guys, continue. There's plenty of space over on this side. Nice one. Who loved that new song tonight? Yeah? It was good? We should do it again? I lost my announcement sheet. That's all right. Take it off. Who reckons I should take this off? Who reckons I should keep it on? Yeah! All right, I'll take it off. No, but go the Blues. Better luck next year, Tykes. Hey, we want to especially welcome some people tonight. Have we got our, yeah, they're ready to go. We have a couple of new people, which I saw one already filling out a form, so it isn't that great. But hands up if you are new tonight. We'd love to give you a chocolate and give you a form. We got Ava over here. You're not new. Anyone else? I know we had another young man who already filled one out, but you can put your hand up as well, Jaden, down here. Let's give a warm welcome to our new people tonight, Ava and Jaden. Great to have you guys with us. Super. Make sure you make them feel welcome. If you haven't introduced yourself to them yet, then make sure you do, because they're part of the family. All right, we're going to get our attention set now on the stage and on me, so we're going to quiet down because we have some exciting announcements to go through. Yeah, good, good. So, as those forms are being handed out, we have a few things happening in the life of our youth. Who knows what's happening next week? Life groups, not just any life groups, but life groups at homes. Very good, we're excited. Do you know where you're going already? We're gonna put it up on the screen for you. So next week, we are not here listening. We are not here. We are elsewhere. So this is where you are. If you are a year seven, we'll go to the next slide. Year seven boys are at Callum's house. Hand up, Callum. There he is. You're at 5 Wiltshire Place. So it might be a good idea to write these addresses down just in case. We're gonna send them out in a text, but write them down if you don't know where you're going. Callum's house for year seven boys. Holly's house for the year seven girls. It's also my house, but you're going there, it's gonna be great. Year eight boys, where are you guys at? Year eight boys, at Rowan's house. Hands up, Rowan. One Bronte Corkrow North. Year eight girls are at Maddie's house, 25 Regency Rides in Chernside. We were there for youth supper a little earlier, so you've had a taste of that house already, it's great. Year nine boys at Nathan's house, 28 Paula Way, Chernside, there's Nath. Don't tell, actually do tell him that. Do you want to know the scores for Collingwood? No, he's already checking. Yeah, doesn't matter, doesn't matter. Year nine girls are at Anita's house. Anita is at 17 Regent Avenue, Moorabbuck. So make sure you get there. Year 10, 11 boys, that's us. Woo-hoo. Josh Blacker's house, 34 Boyana Crescent, Croydon. What are you laughing at? Woo-hoo. That's what we do in year 10, 11 boys, because we're tough. Year 10, 11 girls are at the Barker's house for Laura Lane in Moorabbuck. And finally, we're at year 12s. Yes. Year 12s, you're at Tegan's house and Luke's house, but Tegan's house this night, 17A, Leanne Crescent, Croydon. So everyone know where you're going next week? Everyone excited? Invite your friends along. It's going to be great. Always good fun. Life groups at homes. Now, get your attention again. Shh, good job. In 2 weeks' time, we have a live night, and this is going to be a live night with a bit of a twist, so we can have that slide up for that next one. This live night is called a response night, and it's not just any live night. We're going to make this night, because it's our last one for the term, we're going to make this special. So we're going to have a whole lot of games going on outside for the first chunk of time. Then we're going to have some burgers. Anyone like burgers? Yeah, we're going to have free burgers, so you can come down here and have a burger. Then we're going to come up here, and we're going to allow God to do his thing on this night. So we're going to have some praise and worship, and then we're going to have a bit of a response, because it's great to hear a message, it's great to hear from the sage, but it's also even better to be able to respond to those messages. So we've had a chunk of really good stuff, and we're going to be about to hear another one from Andy in this term so far, and we want to give you an opportunity to respond to a few calls on this night. So we're pumped for this night. We hope you are too. Great night to invite your friends. So get along, going to be great in 2 weeks. And finally, last thing of the term, you only got 3 weeks and then you're on holidays. This is what we're doing to celebrate for our social. Let's turn our attention to the screen.
It's unsafe for you to have that.
But why?
You don't need to know that.
Well, at least let me go with you.
That too is unsafe. But if you need me, I'll always be with you. I won't forget you.
Oh, thanks. Well, I just don't want you to go. I think I love you. Let me see you again.
I can't miss business with pleasure. But if you want to meet me here tomorrow at lunch at the Lillardale roller skating rink.
Okay.
Excited to see my Batman. Riddler.
Today is sunny, tomorrow is rain. If you don't bring the chest, I will inflict pain.
Wheels.
Good. There's some details for ya. Just the end credits. Very good. Give him a hand. How good was that? So on the 8th of April, we are going roller skating. Who likes roller skating? Yeah, good fun. And it's superhero themed, in case you didn't pick up on that. So dress up as a superhero and you can win a prize if you are best dressed. All right, so registrations are now open. You do have to register, so you can't just rock up. You've got to do that online at lmc.org.au/events. So make sure you get on that, and there's a flyer to take on the way out. Good? We excited? Great. Now, I couldn't be more excited to have our very own Mr. Pastor Andrew Hunt, who, Mr. Pastor, he used to, did you know, how many people knew that he used to run Frontline? Yes. How many people didn't know that he used to be? Yeah, a few people. This is the first time he's been back, having been the pastor for many, many years of Frontline. And now he is the lead pastor of LMC, our church. So he is our lead pastor, and he has come on his Friday night to share with each and every one of you. So let's give him the biggest, warmest welcome this evening.
Thank you, Matthew. Yo! Man, it is so good to be back at Frontline after so long. And I've been looking forward to this night, seeing all y'all. Who is Batman? Schwabby, that was a legit accent right there. That was great. That was one of the best Batmans. I mean, pretty much you just go deep and then just... That's pretty much Batman right there, isn't it? Where are the drugs? That's what he says. Very good, man. And as Matt said, I used to be youth pastor here, and I was here a little while ago, a few years ago. I came and I actually went to youth with my now wife, and this is a photo of my wife, myself, and our kids. Up on the screen in a second. There they are. Look, that's Judah on the side. That's Roman above my head, and Olive on the side as well. Roman, yes, Roman, a boy with long hair. It is a boy with long hair. And so that is my family. I love them very much. But a couple other things that I love. I love theme parks. Anybody? Yeah. Theme parks. I love video games. Anybody? Yes. The boys go, yes. And I love NBA basketball. Anybody? Yes, they're three passions of mine. They're three. If you get all three those three things on the same day for me, I am a happy, happy man, that's for sure. But apart from that, like, there's some things that make me happy during the day, but who knows as well that life sometimes is really tough, and we have really tough days, and sometimes the theme park is not there to bring us joy. But I tell you what, there is no joy that can be found like living a life serving Jesus Christ, and I love him so much. More than anything else in my life, and whether it's a good day or a bad day, it is a good day when you're serving Jesus. And I'm so thrilled that he is a part of my life and that I get to serve him in this way as well. I tell you what, a few years ago, my family and I, 2018, we went on an overseas trip and we actually went to Disneyland. My parents like saved up and took my kids and me and my brother and his kids over to Disneyland before the pandemic. So thank you for that, God, that we got in at that time. And it was an amazing trip. And we knew where we were going. And when you know where you're going on a trip, you know what to pack, right? Have you ever been on a big trip, maybe a school camp? And you think about it maybe the night before, or you think about it that morning, you think about what to pack. Well, we knew what we had to pack when we were going to Disneyland. And I've got a case here with some stuff in it, and I'm going to get that table as well, because I've got some things to show you in a minute. This bag here has some items in it, and I want you to figure out where we're going based on the items, all right? All right, what have I got here? I've got some markers. No, don't shout it out because you'll be wrong. Okay. I've got a basketball. All right. It's a basketball. I have got, this is a rashi. I've got some swimming clothes. Yep, and I've got some board shorts there. Okay. You figured it out yet? I've packed for our trip. I got a packet of Oreos. Double stuff. I know, they're good, right? Packet of Oreos. I've got my son's Switch, all right, ready for the trip, okay? That's ready to go. And one last thing. I have my drill, all right? I've got my drill. So I think I'm ready. Can you guess where I'm going? All right. It's a bit hard to guess. I get it. I packed this today with no destination in mind. I didn't know where I was going. So I've tried to hedge my bets. You know, I don't know whether I'm going to need food there or whether I need a ball to maybe play with or some swimming clothes to go swim. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what my destination is. So I don't really know what to pack. And if you don't know what your destination is, then you don't know how to prepare for where you're going. And if we are going to live a life, like you've been speaking about, on the front line, we better know what that destination is so that we know how to prepare for it when we get there. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. And my title for the message, if you're writing notes, who's writing notes tonight? Anybody? That is the way to do it. That's the way to remember what's spoken about tonight, is to write notes. And the title for my message is this: Disneyland or the North Pole? Disneyland or the North Pole? If you're after a more accurate title for the message, it's this next slide. Know your destination, nail your preparation. If you know your destination, then you will be able to nail your preparation. Matt used a great analogy a couple of weeks ago about the game Territories. And being on the front line when it comes to Territories, you've got that line, and there's that no man's land, or that as soon as you cross that, you're able to be tagged, you're able to be hit. But really, a front line relates to a battle. If you're in a war and you've got a battle, being on the front line of that battle means that you are standing as close as you can to the enemy. The enemy is on the other side of that line. And so if you are on the front line, you are facing the enemy. And I want to make no mistake tonight that there is a battle that is going on for your life. You have come here tonight, and perhaps you've been able to think about that, and you go, Andy, I don't know you, but I know that there's some battle going on, because sometimes it feels really hard. Life feels really hard. And sometimes it's going really good, and I don't know why. It's because there is a battle going on for your life. There is a battle of good and evil that is raging even right now. And living on that front line means that not only are we aware of that battle, but we also need to be prepared for that battle. Being on the front line is being prepared for that battle. You guys have been learning about the armor of God out of Ephesians 6, and I encourage you to keep learning about, keep reading that. That's a daily thing that we need to do is put on the armor of God. In life groups, we've reread them. So you can do that. So tonight I want to look at one aspect of what it is to be on the front line. We're not going to look at what it looks like, but we're going to look at what it sounds like. Write that down. What it sounds like to be on the front line. What does it sound like on the front line? When I was at school many, many years ago, I enjoyed school, but the academic side of it, it wasn't so fun. I was probably like a B student, like, if I'm really honest, maybe C+, you know. Maybe if I'm really honest, I was more like a C student, you know. The sports carnivals were amazing. That's where I lived. Anybody else? We live for the sports carnival. That is the day. That was me. But I want to tell you a story tonight about three guys that were A+ students. They were A+, not only A+, but A++. These guys were the best of the best. They were the ducks. And these three guys in the Bible, we're going to read this story together, are these three guys, Shadrach, Meshach, and if you know it, say it with me, Abednego. Abednego. These guys were Israelites. They were God's people. And Israel had been captured in this time by this other nation, Babylon. They were the enemy. And these guys had been captured. And what the leaders of Babylon did was they took the best of the best. And they thought, if we're going to be better as a nation, we need these best guys because they got the good brains. And so what they try and do is take these guys out of Israel. They try and plug them into the Babylon system, rewire their brains so that they are marching for Babylon instead. And there's this fourth guy called Daniel, and he writes this book of the Bible we're about to read from. They were tested with food. The king of Babylon, King Nebuchadnezzar, said to these guys, hey, I want you to get big and strong, and I'm going to give you some special food to do it. All right? Big and strong. And what they did was they offered it to them, and the guys said, hang on a second. God said we're not supposed to eat that stuff. So we're actually going to stay here. And they said to the king, effectively, we're going to do this thing called a Daniel. Well, they didn't call it the Daniel fast then. It's called the Daniel fast now because it was Daniel that did it. But they said, we're going to eat vegetables and water for this period of time. And then you test us against the guys who didn't eat that. And we'll see who's stronger. And so he did that. And the king let them. And lo and behold, after that time, they are stronger. And it was a lesson. It was a test for Daniel and his friends as to whether they were going to obey King Nebuchadnezzar or they were going to obey God. They had been tested, and so in other words, they were prepared for what was to come. And this was what was to come. King Neb sets up this 27-meter high golden statue of himself. I mean, like, he's got tickets on himself, that's for sure. And he asks the people, he says, this is a command, I want you to worship this idol. You're going to work, when we play all these weird instruments, you're going to worship this idol. Of course, our boys know that they are only to bow to the one true God. They know the commandment that says, you shall have no other gods before me. And so they're in this dilemma where they know what is right, but they also know that if they don't do what is right, there is going to be consequences to that. If they don't bow down to this idol King Neb had set up, there is going to be consequences to that decision. And don't you and I always face that dilemma? We face it on a daily basis. We face it because we know in a situation what the right thing is to do. You guys sitting here right now, some of you know what the right thing is to do in this situation right now. But there is a challenge, maybe, from the person that is sitting next to you because they might want you to do something else. And there is always consequences to that decision. But the one that holds the consequences, I have this problem all the time with my children, is, are you going to listen to your brother or sister who is egging you on to do this thing, or are you going to listen to your parent who has the control over the consequences? They might think there's going to be consequences on their end, but I, as the parent, actually have the consequences. I hold them. And just the same, King Nebuchadnezzar had consequences. But we serve a God that is above King Nebuchadnezzar. And these guys knew that. And so there was no option for them in here. And so we're going to pick this up in Daniel 3, 13 to 30. And this is a chunk of scripture. And I thought about ripping out this chunk of scripture because I didn't know if you guys could handle a whole chunk of scripture tonight. But I decided against that because you guys are going to read scripture with me tonight because we look at the Word of God at Frontline, yeah? The Word of God, get excited about it. Before we do that, I want to pray. Let's bow our heads. Let's be expectant for God to speak to us tonight. I know He will. And Father God, we right now for these next few minutes, open our hearts to what You want to say to us. Holy Spirit, we thank You for the way that You work. And I pray that even in our minds, Lord God, even with some of us who 5 minutes of concentration is, that's it, that's all we've got. That tonight it would be 10, it would be 15, it would be 20 minutes, Lord God. We would be concentrating on what You want to say to us this night. So Father, have Your way in us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's look at the screens and let's read this. So, Daniel 3, 13 to 30. This is what happens. Furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king. And Nebuchadnezzar said to them, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego?" Because someone told on them that they weren't being obedient. "Is it true that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold that I've set up? Now when you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the what? Zither? The lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all kinds of music, you are not ready to fall down and worship the image I made? Very good if you are. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing," say it with me, "furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand?" Next verse. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, "King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve," listen to this, "the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. And He will," listen to their confidence, "He will deliver us from your majesty's hand." Verse 18. "But even if He does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you have set up." Next verse. "Then Nebuchadnezzar was furious at the three boys, and his attitude towards them changed. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So these men, wearing all that they had on, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent and the furnace so hot," like, and this is not just a story, this is real, "that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace." Doesn't sound like a happy ending to that story, but we'll get back to it. And speaking of sounds, what does it sound like to be on the front line? People who have ever been in a bushfire would tell you that the sound of a bushfire is like a jet engine. It is so loud. Fire, when it gets that hot, actually creates its own wind. And so it is so loud and so hot. And that when something's so loud, I don't know if you guys have been in an environment where it is just in your face loud. It's so confronting, isn't it? I remember going to the races, the Formula One many, many years ago, and hearing that car go past for the first time, it was like almost put you on your bottom because it was so loud. It's so confronting. But sound is powerful, and it creates emotions, and it creates feelings in us. And I've got some examples for you. I want you to listen to this and see how you feel. Let's go with the first one. So I saw some smiles when that first came on. What did you feel? What was the emotion? Joy, some happiness, because you're about to watch a Disney movie and it was going to be fun for some of you. I saw Rowan over there and he looked as bored as anything with that music. Is that right? Oh, wait, yeah? Maybe at the start of it. Maybe the start. All right, now what about this next one? How do you feel with this next one? All right, kick that. What is that? Does anyone know?
Fortnite.
It is Fortnite. It's Fortnite. So how do you feel when you hear that? Johnny, how did you feel when you heard it?
Oh, I felt so much joy.
Yeah. So much joy from Johnny. All right, now let's see this next one. What do you feel when you hear this? And go to the next one. Don't touch your phone, anybody. Don't. And go to the next one. How many of you right now have the urge to check your phone? How many? See, don't do it. How much that little sound creates that emotion in us, that messenger tone that we need to check what it is. Now, we've got this last one. I think, is this the last one? All right, that's enough. How do you feel when you hear that one? Yes. Your ears were burning. Yes, we feel horrible. The Carlton theme song. Sometimes, for some of you, that Carlton theme song is like, yes, that is the best, because it means Carlton won. For others of you, you don't want to hear that ever again in your life, which is probably quite likely, to be honest. Are we sure? It's late this season. So, there is emotion that's welled up with us when we hear those sounds. And there's going to be different sounds for you that are going to bring up different emotions and different feelings. But what does it sound like when we are standing on the front line? What does it sound like, and then what does that sound do to us? How does that sound impact us is the question we want to ask. The sounds that come across that front line are not sounds of bullets rushing past our head. They are not sounds of bombs going off in the distance like you would hear in war times. The sound on the front line, when we stand on the front line, are sounds like this. You are never going to amount to anything. You are weak. You are worthless. If only people knew what you were really like, they would never want to be your friend. They are the sounds that you hear when you're standing on the front line. Because we face an enemy that doesn't come at you with guns, he doesn't come at you with bombs. He comes at you with lies. And that's what he is throwing across that line. And the closer you stand to that line, sometimes the louder those things get. In the Bible, it says that we face an enemy and he wants to steal from you, he wants to kill you, and he wants to destroy you. He will speak to your fear, he will speak to your self-worth, and he will speak to your desires, and lies are the noises that he makes. Do you fear being alone? Well, he knows that. And he's going to try and get you on that. Do you fear being left out? Well, he knows that too. It's something that we all desire, is to be connected, to be in. But he knows that we've got a fear of being left out. And he will make sure to put you in a position, if he knows that you're going to be left out, to give you an option. You can be left out of this, he will say, or he will light and he will say, but if you want to be in, then I've got the key for you. And he won't tell you this, but let me tell you what it is. The key of compromise is the key that he will offer you. If you want to fit in, then you've got to compromise on some of your values. If you don't want to be left out of this party or of this group, then this is the way to do it. But you're like the three boys
God, I know what the right thing is to do. But this seems so attractive and I need to be there. And so we have a decision to make. And we have a choice. Because that thing coming across the front line to us is that noise is so confronting. And it's so in our face. But you have a choice. We have a choice. And the only reason that we have a choice is because we've come prepared. That I have chosen, can't hear. That I have chosen in that moment, because I've been prepared to put something on my ears that's gonna say, enemy, no, I'm gonna listen to what my God has to say. I'm gonna listen to what my Father has to say right now. Because this noise on the front line needs to be shut up. So enemy, no. I've come prepared for the fight on the front line. Because what God says about me is more important. And what does God say? Write this down tonight. God says this. He says, you are valued. And the first point tonight is I am valued by God. And I want you to know that. And I want you to believe that tonight, that you are valued by God. In Genesis 1, it says, then God said, let us make human beings in our image to be like us. You are made in the image of God. You have the fingerprints of Almighty God on your life right now. And there's good news because God does not make mistakes. And if you ever think, or if anyone ever tells you that you are a mistake, I want you to know that your Creator, your Father God, says that is not true. That He does not make mistakes and that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Look at Ephesians 2:10. Write this scripture down. Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. You're not just part of God's creation. You are His masterpiece. Out of His collection of creation, you are the masterpiece, is what it says. He cherishes you, the most brilliant part. So I want you to hear this truth tonight, that you are valued by God. The next thing that the enemy throws across at us is this. He says, or the next noise, and the way to counter that noise is to know that it is God and not the enemy that wants the best for you. It is God and not the enemy that wants the best for you. And one of the tricks that the enemy plays on us is he lures us with this twisted version of the truth. And there's a great example of this. And we look at this truth in 1 John 1, 8 and 9. I told you I'm going to give you some scripture tonight. Let's lean into this. It says, if we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to Him, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all wickedness. We have sin. We all miss the mark on a daily basis. But here's the promise. Leave that up for a second. One second for us. In verse 9, if we confess our sins to Him, this is the truth. That God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. But what the enemy would say is, you have sinned and you should be so embarrassed. No one's going to forgive you for that. You are the worst. That's what he'll say about this very same situation. But that's not what God says. Let's know the lies. Let's know what's coming across. Let's know the sound of that front line. And so when it's chaotic and confusing, we don't know what to remember, choose. Be prepared. Put them on. Say, no, enemy, that's a lie and it needs to go back there. And I'm going to concentrate and I'm going to listen to what God says. Number one, you are valued by God. Number two, it is God
and not the enemy that wants the best for you. So we're going to finish the story, and I've just got four quick things for you to take away tonight. And so we come back, and the guys have just been thrown into the fiery furnace, and the guards are laying crispy on the ground. And let's see what it says in verse 24. Then King Nebuchadnezzar leapt to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, "Weren't there three men that we tied up and threw into the fire?" They replied, "Certainly, Your Majesty." He said, look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the fourth looks like a son of the gods." Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and the satraps, the prefects, the governors, and the royal advisors crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, come on, nor was a head of their hair of their heads singed, their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire in them. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, this is the turning point, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own. Therefore, I decree that the people of any nation or language who say anything against God, their God, will be cut into pieces and their houses will be turned into piles of rubble. For no other god can save in this way." Then the king promoted the boys in the province of Babylon. What a story. What a victory. What a turnaround. These three men stood on the front line of battle, and because of their confidence in God and the way that they were able to hear his voice over the doubts that the enemy spoke, they were able to see a victory in their lives and impacted so many others because of it. So, let's recap. On the front line, if we're going to live on the front line, we need to know that we're in a battle. We need to know that there is a sound that is coming and that our enemy is real. But we serve a God that is greater, who has the power to overcome, and who did overcome by sending Jesus to earth to become our Savior. And he has also prepared you for what it's going to be like on the front line. And here's what you need to pack. And Trav, if I can have you up, man, to play me out, that'd be great. And here's what you need to pack. I've got four things that you need to pack on your way to the front line. If you're going to be there, if you're going to live on the front line like we're talking about, like Jesus wants us to, here's four things you need to bring with you. Number one, you need to, I can get rid of these things because they don't matter anymore. Get rid of it. Number one thing we need to bring, if we're going to stop the voices already, we need to bring the right voice. This is my Bible. This is my Bible. But this is the Word of God. This is the right voice. And if we're going to pack to be able to win the battle and stand on the front line, then this is what we need to bring. Number one, the Word. Turn down the enemy and turn up what God says in your life, because he loves you more than anyone could. Hear me right now. Look at me, everyone. God loves you more than anybody ever could. More than anybody ever could. And it's revealed to us right here in his word, in what he says about you. It's your Creator's voice. The second thing, so number one, we bring the right voice, our Bible. Number two, we bring the helper. I've got a Sharpie. John 14, 26 says this, "But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things, and he will remind you of all that I said to you." The Holy Spirit is with you.
And if Jesus is Lord of your life, then he is your helper and he is your guide. I know if ever I'm in a pickle, if I'm in a tough moment, all I need to do is say, Holy Spirit, I need your help. Holy Spirit, I need you right now. I need your wisdom in this moment. Holy Spirit, I need to have your perspective over what I'm going through because it doesn't make sense to me. And if you allow him, he will guide you. And this is what it is. Got our Sharpie, and the Sharpie is, there's no magic in the Sharpie, nothing special about the Sharpie. But what I've written on my hand, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Because you know, the truth about the Holy Spirit is, he is there, he is with you. He's already with you at the front line. But if you bring your Sharpie and write it somewhere so that you can see it, then you know that he is there. It's not about him taking him with you, it's about remembering that he is there. He is with you on the front line. And every time that we look at our hands to try and do it in our own strength, oh, it's by the Holy Spirit. Because of the Holy Spirit. And he's working in your life. 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you? The third thing that you need to bring to the front line with you, I want you to look at your leader for a second. Look at one of your leaders. The third thing that you bring with you to the front line is your leader. Is your frontline leader. Because they're with you as well. They're there with you at the front line. They're when you need them. And you do need them. And sometimes you're going to be going through certain things in your life and you need to make a phone call and you need to say to your leader, hey, I just don't know how to make sense of this. Man, my life is just, it's not going good at the moment. Hey, can you pray for me? And they are there for you. Amen, leaders. They're carrying the presence of God and they will help you. And the last thing to remember when you're on the front line, when we're hearing it, to get prepared for when we go. Look around. You need the frontline fam. You need your frontline fam. The family that's around you. Because look me in the eye, everyone right now. You are not alone. Look at my eyes. You are not alone. Your family is here with you. And though you might be battling what you think is a battle on your own, we are standing on the front line with you. And we want to see you have a victory in that area of your life. So we're going to stand. So if we're going to stand on the front line, if we're going to survive on the front line, we must stay together. Even when it's hard, stay together. Even when someone offends you, stay together. Even when your friend says something that you don't agree with or has some behavior that you don't agree with, stay together. Because together is how we are going to survive on the front line with that enemy coming at us. So being on the front line is not easy. But it's what we're made for. It's the way Jesus has us live. Serve him, to live for him, to fight back what the enemy is trying to do. Steal, to kill and destroy in us and in the lives of our friends. And your preparation starts now. Pack your bag every day. Come to youth every week. Every week. Life groups at homes next week. Come along. Keep fighting. And so as we close tonight, I just want to pray for a few people. If you close your eyes, it's just a moment of respect for the people around us and a moment for you to respond to God. I want to pray for people who would say,
Andy, I think I've perhaps taken a step back from the front line. But I'm ready to step back up. And I'm going to pack my bag with the word. I know that the Holy Spirit is with me, and I'm going to remind myself of that with my leader, and with my frontline fam. And I'm going to start fighting again. I have listened to too many lies. And if that's you, I'm not going to ask you to stand. I'm going to pray for you. If you want to say, Andy, I'm committing right now to stepping up to that front line. I'm going all in. I want you to just put your hand up quickly. I'm going to pray. Is anyone here tonight? I see. Just leave it up. Leave it up. It's just me looking around. Come on. Come on. This is not just a light call. I know this is a serious thing. All right, you can put those hands down. We're going to pray. Can we stand, front line? Can we stand? And why don't you come up here, Maddie, for me? Can you just get, like, at the risk of this being a bit weird, I would love you to hold the hand of the person next to you. I would love you to do that. And boy, yeah, boys, arms around each other is fine. And this is much more than the physical holding of a hand. This is representing the fight that we fight together. This is being on the front line together. Together with one another as a frontline family, on the front line, fighting the battle. The person next to you might, in a week's time, start believing a lie that has come across the front line, because it's easy. I want you to fight for them and say, hey, get that lie out of here. We're going to believe what God says right now. Remember what that guy, remember what is his name, Andy, said at youth, that you are valued by God, that he loves you. We're going to remind each other of that. Amen? Yeah? All right, come on. Let's close our eyes. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this night, and we thank you for the ability that we have right now to come before you. And Father, as we hold hands across this place and stand united in this battle against the enemy who is coming for all of us, Lord God, we say we put you first right now. And we say that as we step up to that front line, we step up not with a fear, because we are serving the God that is above all things. And just as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stood up to the king, we stand up to the enemy and we say, no, you will not rob from us anymore. You will not steal from that person that I'm holding the hand of anymore. We pray for restoration. We pray for healing, Lord God, in their lives, in the name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name. Just squeeze that hand of the person next to you right now as a commitment to them that, hey, I'm with you on this. I'm with you on this. We're not going to fall together. I am with you on this, and we are going to get back and get going. So, Father, we give you all the glory tonight. As much as we pray about things that we want to do, Lord God, at the end of the day, we understand that it is not in our own strength, but it is in your strength that you ask us to live. So, Holy Spirit, we give ourselves to you afresh and say, have your way in us. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. 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 Thanks, Maddie. Come and take over.
Awesome. Why don't we thank Pastor Andy for that amazing word. So good. We let's get the band up here just real quick. We're going to finish at 9:32 tonight. So I apologize for your parents, because we're going to sing that praise song. And I think it would be fitting right now to jump around and sing the revival anthem, because what we've done tonight is not just something that
there's not just something that passes us by. It's not just something that we put our hand up for and we stood together for and we just, you know, that was nice. We all, you know, sung Kumbaya. It's not about that. This is real. And this is something that we get to declare every single day of our lives. And it starts right here in giving God the praise. So we're going to praise like nothing else. We're going to jump around. We're going to sing our revival anthem tonight and see dry bones come to life. Yeah? How good. Let's do it. So get rid of those bean bags, yeah, chuck them over the side.
Yeah, we don't want to be tripping over any bean bags.
It's an incident waiting to happen. Yeah.
Frontline, all right, there it is, 9:32 on the dot. Go say good,
go say hello to your parents and give them that song, hey, on the way home. Give them a belt because that is a ripper. So good to have you here tonight. Let's thank Andy one more time, hey. Let's give him a hand. And as always, guys, we... That's it. I know it's exciting. I know there are hugs going around everywhere. That's great. We are a frontline family here, and the leaders always are here to chat with you. And I know, you know, we danced around, we sung, we linked arms and all that kind of stuff, and it might seem a little excitable right now, but there was a really important word there as well. And if you need to chat about something, then our leaders are going to be hanging around, and we'd love to chat with you for the... don't wait. We want to do it straight away so your parents aren't waiting, but come and chat to one of our leaders. Don't leave without chatting if you need to. Otherwise, we will see you at church on Sunday morning, at LMC, and life groups at homes next Friday night. Don't forget to grab a flyer for roller skating. Register now, and we'll see you next week. Go have a great weekend.